Hey everybody, this is Curtis from PSNstores.com. Today we are looking at, again, Dark Cloud. This is the fourth episode of this playthrough. And, oh god, so here's what happened. I got about 40 minutes into this, in today's episode, and I looked over at my capture gear, and I noticed that the mic was not selected. So, basically what that means is this video came out and there was no microphone audio. There's game audio, video, and that came out fine. But not my microphone. So, we have post commentary today, which is not going to be a normal thing. That was my mistake. Usually my capture stuff remembers my previous settings, but for whatever reason, it like reverted to old settings and everything was out of whack. And luckily, it mostly was just my own microphone that was affected because it wasn't selected. So, hopefully, this is okay. I know it's not gonna be... It's not the way that I prefer to do it, where I'm talking as I'm playing, but... We'll see how this goes. Hopefully, this is okay. So, today is a lot of just progression into the dungeon. It's, I think there's like 15 floors in this dungeon. So, we get decently far into it. We don't finish today. I won't say anything more. Nothing story related really happens. It's a lot of just progressing further. And I guess I'll talk specifically about the new character once we get to her, because we're going to be using her for a little bit, or a decent chunk of today's episode. We're playing as her, so. And I think there's a number of things in this episode that happens. It's like, okay, I need to evaluate how I'm going to handle the multiple party members. Specifically, Ginny, she starts out and her weapon isn't leveled up yet. It's just, like you saw there, it's got a 4 attack. So it's doing nothing to enemies, as you'll see. So it's, I'm thinking, and we'll see how it goes. We'll see what happens as we get more party members. But I'm thinking it might need to be a thing where maybe once we get a new party member, we might have to go grind a little bit just to get their weapons up to snuff. Because what happens is, I think it's this next floor, there is, it's one of the, I don't remember the name of it, it's one of the restricted floors, so that basically I could only use her on that floor. And that was rough, because it was a lot of enemies that were pretty hard, and were taking a lot, like, they had a lot of health. And so I was doing like one damage to each of them. And that's never good. Maybe it might be the next floor after this one, actually. Yeah. Because it's the floor that doesn't have any of these Atla. So, that was fun. And I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get there. But for now, I did want to say, mention briefly, because this is actually the first episode I recorded after having started to post these to the site and on YouTube. And we got some comments, so thank you for listening. Thank you if you've been, or listening. Thank you for watching, I should say. And also I got a tip from someone, and I meant to pull up your name before I started recording this, but I just completely forgot to, because it is like, it's midnight and I just got home from work. So, but I did get some pretty cool tips, specifically on the treasure chests, the really large ones that are rigged with a trap. You actually see, we deal with one later in this episode, and I won't spoil what happens, but basically he was saying that, or he or she, I don't know, was saying that basically there's 3 traps that are possible that you can guess, and if you guess the right one, you get the treasure and you don't take harm, but if you guess the wrong one, you set off that trap. And the 3 different traps, it's poison, it's explosive, and there's another one, I forget the third one. But basically, the way it's set up is that if you pick explosive and you get it right, then good. Then you get the item, no harm done. But if you get it wrong and you pick explosive, the other 2 traps aren't going to destroy the chest, so you'll be fine. So you'll actually be okay. Whereas, like, let's say you chose poison and the trap was explosive, the chest would blow up. So that was actually a really cool tip, and it makes total sense. That kind of like, I mean, you still have to kind of know, like, okay, I need to make sure that if I do this, I have the antidotes or I have the items that I can use to recover if I'm wrong, which is likely to happen, you know, at some point. So we'll get to see how that turns out. Also, another thing that the same person said was about the when we're in the main village and there's those little like treasure chests that pop up around the houses. It was specifically about how that's typically where you're gonna get the items that will increase your max health, your max thirst, and things like that. And that was actually something we saw in episode 3, but we see a good bit more of that too. And one thing, like, I feel like now that I'm thinking about it and talking about it again, is it actually kind of reminds me of Persona 4 specifically, where you just kind of get into this routine of doing things. 4, obviously, there's a lot more to it. But with Dark Cloud, it's like, okay, you go through the dungeon, you maybe go a 4 or 2, then you leave, and then you have some more, you've already recovered Atlas Spheres, probably on those 1 or 2 floors, so then you're gonna use that to build up the village a little more, maybe add some new things, a new building, maybe some new people that you found, and then after you do that, then you walk around, and then you collect the little chests that have shown up next to houses. Maybe you view events if you finished off a specific house or building, and then you go from there. And it's kind of, you just kind of fall into this routine of doing these very specific things in this order. And I feel like that's kind of how I tackle Persona 4. I say that mainly because I've been playing Persona 4 again. I've done like a second playthrough of that over the past like 3 months. I feel like eventually I'm going to finish it. But there's been so many other games out that it's kind of hard to, you know, it's a little rough. So while I wait specifically to talk about Jenny, who I think she's up on the next floor, I'm just going to use this time to talk about a little bit of site-related things. I figured I've got a lot of time to talk and fill in some stuff. So this week we are, I think, looking on doing our Game of the Year stuff, our deliberations. That stuff is going to show up the last week of the year, so that'll be pretty cool. Hopefully we can get some, like, reader-specific awards. I don't know that we're going to, like, record a deliberations podcast. I think we're going to try to record something where we specifically go over our favorites of the year. That'll be cool. If you missed it earlier, I guess you missed it yesterday, Sunday afternoon. I was streaming, and I was talking about how I now have stuff to record Vita videos. Anything that's compatible with PlayStation TV, I can record now. So, looking to be doing a lot more of that, in addition to just PS4 games, which will be cool. I think there's like 2 or 3 Vita games I've got lined up. So hopefully that'll start coming out throughout the next week or so. Alright, sorry, I was waiting for my dog to stop. But yeah, so we should be getting more Vita stuff, videos and coverage like that, hopefully, in the next, actually, it should start this week. There's gonna be, like, Fat Princess, video review and all that jazz, Nuclear Throne, all that stuff, which actually I've been playing. I finished Fat Princess, Adventures, and then I've been playing a lot of Nuclear Throne, which I'm not very good at. So I have not got to the Nuclear Throne yet. That game's pretty cool. It's like, I don't know, I'm not huge into like the roguelike style of games. There's only really a couple of them that I've ever got into. And I guess like, I mean, not really, but in a weird way, Dark Cloud kind of has elements of that. I mean, maybe like specifically the thirst meter, probably. But I don't know, yeah, Nuclear Throne's pretty cool. It's the, I don't know, like, it's got the heavy screen shake, which luckily you can turn down. I don't know that I hate it. I know Eric and I were talking about it over the weekend, and he's definitely not a fan of the screen shake, which is fine. But you can, well, it's funny, we found out while I was streaming It defaults to 100%, and you can turn it down to 0 if you want, but you can also crank it up to 200%, which I thought was kind of funny. But, so yeah, I don't know. We'll have, like, actual coverage of that, this week. Among the Sleep is another thing we'll cover. I'll have a review of that soon. Hopefully today, actually. Hopefully that review will be up today or tomorrow. Fat Princess was interesting. I need to play it with more people. I played it mostly single player. I did do a little bit of four player co-op over the weekend, and that was pretty cool. It was actually really easy just to get people to join my game. Like, I just opened it up to anyone, and I got 3 people really, really quick, which is pretty cool. But I would like to play that with friends too. Let's see what that is like. It was surprising to me how similar it was to Diablo, I guess, in the way the world is structured. Because you go on some mainline quests, but there's like side missions that you can accept. I mean, the worlds are separated by like load screens, but like each area is pretty big for the most part. There's actually a pretty big town that you go through, which I thought was pretty cool. So, I don't know. It was a pretty cool little game. There were some things about it, like specifically the humor, I did not care for at all. There's a lot of like cake is a lie jokes and other like humor of that kind of style where maybe it was funny a couple years ago and now it's like I'm good. There's a like you choose a personality for your created character, so you can have like kind of like a clown. You can have, I think there's like one called emo, there's one that is kind of your knight in shining armor kind of style, and I guess they're okay. They talk a lot, which can get kind of annoying. But they will like, they'll say these random things like hashtag awesome sauce when you're doing well. And that's, I mean, it kind of goes hand in hand with the fact that you have like an awesome sauce meter that you can charge and activate to like do a bunch of extra damage. But I don't know, like, the humor in that game is real, not like really, really weird and off. And I usually like dumb humor like that, and I wasn't feeling it. But the game itself is actually pretty fun. Like, it's, I think if you're into Diablo, it's definitely like that. Maybe not as good, but it's definitely got some pretty good stuff going on for it. The final boss is kind of a butt single player, but that is what it is. And I did So you see Ginny's candy there, which increases her defense, which is good. But I did want to mention, and I let it pass by, that statue dog that I was flipping out about a few episodes ago. We were playing Rogue Galaxy. We started up playing that. I've played about the first hour. And one, that game holds up super well. It still plays really well. It looks pretty good. So I'm super excited to like get back into that and play through it again. But the other thing is that in the opening of that game, as you're fighting through waves of enemies, one of the enemies we ran into was a statue dog straight out of Dark Cloud. They were a little, I kind of thought of them as statue puppies. They're a bit smaller than the ones in this game. But as soon as I saw it, I was like, oh, dude, that's it. That's the enemy from Dark Cloud. Which one was just super cool to see. But it also got me thinking a lot about the fact that, like, that's, I wonder, like, again, you know, when I played Rogue Galaxy, I didn't really remember a lot from Dark Cloud 1 or 2, and so I'm actually wondering now that as I'm playing through Dark Cloud and then as I go through Rogue Galaxy, if there's going to be things that maybe also are referencing Dark Cloud. In a way that, like, when I see them in Rogue Galaxy again, it's like, oh, okay, like, I get that now, like, that's from Dark Cloud. That's super cool. So, hopefully that's the case, like, I already lost my mind at the fact that my favorite enemy, Statue Dog, is also in Rogue Galaxy, which was super cool. See, it really bums me out, because this episode I like really got into the building, the town, and talking a lot about it. We finish up a lot of houses today. I think Laura's house is almost done. Not to spoil it, Paige's house. We'll end on Paige's house, so I'm actually gonna... I'll stop talking, like, towards the end of this. Because we end up on Paige's house, and it leads to some pretty cool stuff. Alright, So the weird thing, and I think this is coming up, for some, like, I thought that I was gonna be able to connect the river to the pond, but you can't do that. Like, it just straight up would not let me do that. So you'll actually see that pretty soon, I think. Cause I'm definitely, like, Because right here, it's like, yeah, no, I think I'll, like, have the river come out and into the pond, and we got some bridges and whatnot, and I tried to do that, and it was not having it. So I don't, which is weird, because I figured I would just be able to have the river empty out into the pond, but I don't know if there's a specific piece that I need or what, or if it just doesn't let me do that in this game, which kind of ruined a little bit of my plan, but that'll be okay. I'm actually really happy with how this is turning out overall. I think... I think there's still going to be a couple of things that I might move around a bit. But, like, right now, seeing how it is now and also knowing where we end up in this episode, like, I'm really happy with how the village is turning out. It has me pretty excited to see it when it's finally done, like, and we have everything. So back into the Divine Beast Cave. So anyways, as this continues on, one other thing is, I bought War of the Monsters, which is another PS2 game that's available. So that is three PS2 games that I have as on these, like, PS4 or PS2, whatever. And I've played, at the very least, at least an hour of each of them. And, I mean, again, that is specifically for Dark Cloud, Rogue Galaxy, and War of the Monsters, but right now, Dark Cloud is actually the only one that I've noticed any sort of weirdness going on, and that's specifically that little line that shows up every once in a while, like, it was mostly in the cutscenes. But in Rogue Galaxy, the hour, we played about an hour and 10 minutes, did not notice anything, there, like, that seemed totally fine. So far at least, like, there's, obviously, that's a long game, there is room for maybe some weird graphical glitches or frame rate errors or anything like that, but at least from my experience, nothing seems out of the ordinary there. I don't have the game on PS2 running to compare it, but it seemed to go pretty fine. Dark Cloud actually is really good too, and I still, as I'm playing more and more, I'm continuously surprised at how well this is holding up. But at, like, I mean, again, there was just that one little error with that little graphical glitch, which I've already seen a couple times in this episode. But then War of the Monsters I played. I actually played a little bit on stream Sunday afternoon. And again, noticed nothing wrong with it. Like, it ran completely fine. And that game also is, like, super fun. If you missed it, like, the only War of the Monsters that I ever played was, like, a demo. It was on a demo disc that a friend of mine had. So I played very, very little of that game, but I always wanted to play it and check it out. So I went ahead and bought it. It was just $10 or whatever. But it's a lot of fun. Like, it actually, like, there's some parts of it that control-wise takes some getting used to, but I had a lot of fun with it, and it's one of those things that, like, after playing for about 20 minutes of it, I was ready to be like, alright, I would love to have another one of these. Like, I don't know the chance of that happening, but something like this, where you just take a big roster of, like, monsters, whether it's movie monsters or whatever, and you just make a fight, like a 3D arena fighting game out of it would just be so awesome. And if not, I'm happy with this too. The thing that really stuck out immediately to me on that was just like the menu presentation. It starts out, there's a lot of like movie posters, like remember like monster movie posters and stuff, and that look really cool. But there's like I think it's like a drive-in or something where the main menu screen is like kind of projected onto. And if you go to options, it actually like zooms out and then zooms in on a diner. And then the diner like menu has a bunch of different options. And then if you, I think if you go, when you go to like your monster select, it's on like a big billboard. So all of it's like specifically within this city that's been constructed for the menu system. I thought that was super cool. Like just the presentation on that alone is something that we don't always get. I feel like a lot of games, nothing against games that don't go over the top like that, but I feel like it really just adds a lot to it, I think, and it's something we don't typically get a lot. Some games do, and like they, I feel like it's when you come across that game that has like that extra level and that added depth of like presentation, whether it's just the menus or whatever, like for me it makes me appreciate that game a little bit more. It was something that stuck out to me with the first Persona 5 trailer we got, but it was like the Persona 5 trailer we got early this year. That was the first big like blowout of like gameplay and everything. And there's that part where they're going through the shop menus, and you start seeing the just like the way that the shops are gonna look, and just the like overall aesthetic of these menus and everything, and it just looks second to none. Like it was like, I remember watching that trailer. I've probably seen that trailer like 20 times now, and every time I watch it, I'm just like, this is the best looking shop ever, or just like these are the best looking menus. And they're just so slick, and they're easy to read. Like it's easy to, I mean, I think it's not translated, at least what we saw of it in that video, but you can imagine like that. Yeah, that looks exactly how it needs to. Like it still retains what you would expect from Persona, but it's got this really nice like slick interface. It looks very simple. It doesn't look super complicated. And you can imagine that once it's translated, like it would look totally fine, but also look be really fun just to look at and go through. It's actually something I appreciate about, I mean, Dark Clouds doesn't have that like that level of like just style, but I found so far that they're just the menus here and like upgrading things and going through the inventory has been pretty simple. Like it's a pretty simple little menu system. I feel like level 5 tends to be pretty good at anyways, at least most of the games that I've played from them. Could be wrong, maybe I'm forgetting something, but I don't know. I think that's when I realized I didn't have any antidotes. Which was a problem, but there it is. So the other thing I thought was interesting about War of the Monsters was actually that I was like reading up about it, And I guess that was, like, I found an old PlayStation blog post back when it was a PS2 classic on PlayStation 3. So there's a blog post written up about that version when that was releasing from like 2 to 3 years ago. And it was about, it was written by, I think Dylan Job from like Warhawk and Starhawk. And I guess like he had worked on the game at like back way, way back. And one thing that someone mentioned that I don't know, I didn't actually follow up to see if this is something that actually worked at least on PS3 classics or PS2 classics for PS3. But I guess if you had Twisted Metal Black and you had like a save file from that game, it actually unlocked a monster in War of the Monsters. And I think that's interesting and maybe something worth checking out and looking into is because Twisted Metal Black is also one of the games available as a PS2, PS4 game. So I don't know if that was ever a thing that like was confirmed for the PS3 version. But I wonder if that might actually work, if you might get have a save file from Twisted Metal Black, if that might actually unlock something in the game. I'm not a huge Twisted Metal fan, so I didn't buy Twisted Metal Black, but I might look that up, or if you know the answer, let me know, because I'd be interested. That'd be kind of cool. I guess that would fit in with a lot of these games kind of retaining specific things about them. It's actually something I talked about in this episode, even though my mic was not plugged in, was specifically I was talking about Final Fantasy VII. The PC port that released on PS4 apparently has like some cheat codes enabled, or sort of cheat codes. There are three things off the top of my head that I know of. It's if you hit L3, you can like fast forward through battles. If you hit L3 and R3 at the same time, it's one of two things. It's I think both at the same time turns off random encounters. And then if you hit R3, I think it like instantly restores all of your MP and HP and whatnot. Or it's like it instantly fills your limit break and then it restores HP. Something like that. So the last one is kind of like, that's like, okay, you know, don't use that. But I really like the first two, just being able to turn off encounters and also being able to fast forward through things. Mostly just because it's something that when I was playing Bravely Default, I think last year, that game has a lot of super, super user-friendly design about it. It's one of those things where, like, you know, obviously the twist of that game definitely soured a lot of people, and I think it left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths. And it just, like, it was the type of thing that you would bring up Bravely Default, and one of the first things people would bring up is like, yeah, but, man, the last half of that game, ugh. I didn't mind it that much. I still think it's one of my favorite games of that year, despite that part of it. But the thing that, to me, really stood out for Bravely Default was that, like, you could turn off, you had so much control over battles and different elements of this big JRPG of, like, you know, you could turn off random encounters, you could speed them up, you could, like, adjust the experience gain or something, you could, like, change how hard enemies were, all sorts of crazy stuff. And I love that it had that, because I like games that have a lot of grinding, like Disgaea I love, and that those games are, I grind. I don't think grinding is necessarily a bad thing. I mean, we do a little bit of grinding in today's episode, as you'll see. But it's one of those things that I love that the option is present. One, because I think obviously there are a lot of people who kind of maybe stay away from JRPGs or just RPGs in general, because it's like, yeah, but I don't want to spend a couple hours just grinding. Whereas in Bravely Default, it was super cool because if you were underleveled, like, the most I ever had to spend was like maybe 10 minutes, you know, leveling up, and I could do it watching TV or doing something else because I could just change the sliders and make it so that random encounters were almost instantaneous, that the enemies were super hard, so I was getting a ton of HP or XP. And then you could set the auto attack, like the last attacks you were doing, so I could wipe out entire enemy parties in one turn. And it just made it super easy and convenient. And so with this, it's very obviously it's not as robust as the system in that game, but it's kind of cool because, you know, Final Fantasy VII is like, I mean, I think that game actually holds up better than most people think it does. I mean, I played it like 4 months ago again, and it was great. It was fantastic. And it was like, I love going back and experiencing it again, and I'm excited to do that another time before the remake happens. But I think I just like that you can, especially turning off random encounters. Sometimes I just want to explore in an RPG, and it's nice to have the option to just get rid of random encounters for like 20 minutes. And I can always go back and turn it back on and grind a bit if I need to, but Seven's also not that hard of a game, so it shouldn't be an issue. But that kind of led me into thinking about how, when just in like games preservation in general, I feel like retaining the cheat codes and retaining weird glitches and things like that is important. Dark Cloud specifically, it's not a glitch that I plan on using, but this version of Dark Cloud still has a glitch that is like, it's the Broken Dagger glitch. And I was reading about it a few nights ago, and basically what it is you can. It has to do with the Odd Gaffer, his shop. And I think it's like the way that you. Like, if you have it like on the bottom right of your inventory or something, like the cursor on both inventories, yours and the Odd Gaffer's, you can like hit a. Like, I think you hit like right on the D-pad and X at the same time or something, and it instantly gives you a Broken Dagger in your inventory. And then when you use that to combine with another weapon, it like maxes out all of its stats instantly. And that's something that you can do, and you can kind of exploit to get very, very powerful weapons very, very quick, as you can imagine. So that's not something we're gonna be using in this playthrough, you know, don't get me wrong. But I like that it's there, because I feel like I wouldn't say I'm the most passionate person about like preserving everything, but I would like to think that I'm very much on the side of like having everything being in the condition that it was. I guess it's kind of the thing that I was a little iffy on when Mega Man Legacy Collection came out back in August, I believe, is one of the things that they were adamant about was, you know, a lot of the Mega Man games had slowdown. So you'd be playing like Mega Man 4, you'd be going through a stage or fighting a boss, and there'd be a little bit of slowdown on occasion. And I think I want to say Mega Man 3 had like a ton. There was one of them, and I don't remember which one, but one of them when I was playing through it again just had a ton of slowdown. And they're still great games. Like, I love Mega Man, but it was also the kind of thing of like, well, like, I get it from the preservation angle of like, when we're emulating these games, we want them to be in the exact condition that they were in when they first came out. And that's really cool. But it's kind of like you look at these PS2 games, right? And they look a little better, they run a little better. And that's like specifically that angle of it. And it's like, yeah, I feel like if we can make a game run better, then there's no harm done. Like, I saw both sides with Mega Man specifically of like, yeah, the slowdown, fine, whatever. I kind of see your argument. But at the same time, it would be kind of cool to have an option to like get rid of that, because like it'd be nice to play those games without the slowdown. Although at the same time, I feel like maybe those games just aren't the same without it. I don't know. But it's like with Dark Cloud, you know, that's not a glitch I'm gonna take advantage of, but I like that it's there. Because I like performance is one thing, but I feel like if you look at like glitches or passwords or cheat codes or whatever, I feel like that's a bygone era of games. Like, I always think back about like Jak and Daxter had a thing where like he would I think it was Jak, and I think Ratchet might have had these too, where you would like, as you're playing the game, you would get some sort of credits or something, and you could like, there was a collectibles or not collectibles, there was like a specific section of the pause menu you could go into, and you could use it to unlock cheat codes. So like Jak and Daxter, you could unlock a big head mode, you would unlock, I think small head was one, I think maybe some different costumes. Different things like that, and I feel like that is something that has gone away. Definitely after the PS2, Xbox, GameCube era, it felt like that was something that just went away. And I guess, like, some of those things you might find as, like, random DLC or skin packs and stuff, but, like, I kind of, and I guess maybe we don't get as many, like, 3D platformers either, but I kind of miss the big head mode. You know, I miss the really, like, silly, weird stuff like that, because it just added something. It was something about, like, you know, finishing Jack and Daxter and then, like, playing or, like, cleaning up some little side stuff I haven't done, maybe finding the last of the little orbs or whatever, and it just running around with a giant head. And there was something about that that was really fun. Probably much more, like, probably a lot more fun than it really should be. But I miss that it's not there anymore, and I would like, I kind of wish games had those again. It's actually funny, like, Fat Princess kind of has something like that. Sort of, when you're, like, when you reach a checkpoint, it gives you these crowns. And if you're playing with multiple people, you get a bonus to it. And then you can use those crowns to unlock customization options. So not quite cheat codes, but somewhat similar. So I don't think I figured out a good, maybe I did. One thing, and I noticed it in an earlier episode, you can't angle the camera to look up, really. And the reason why I was doing, yeah, because I put the windmill backwards. But, I kind of wish I could, like, angle the camera up a little bit, but no big deal. But interestingly, the interesting thing to note about that windmill was it's Dran's windmill. And Dran is, of course, the guy that we're going after, we're trying to find and track down, so. We got some of his stuff. We don't have him yet. We haven't ran into him, but we're getting close. We're getting very close. I think tomorrow's episode probably will be the one that we finally meet up with him. Oh yeah, here we go. So, this is the special floor that's restricted to only our new character, our new ally. Limited zone. So, we ran into a bit of trouble here. As you'll see pretty quick. Her slingshot is not effective on any enemy. I think the most it was doing was like one hit point of damage, which is not cutting it. Even on like some of the weaker enemies, I think it wasn't doing that much. We got this new enemy, the dragon, who, you know, like she was not doing anything to him. And also, I was being a big dummy here and, like, being kind of stubborn. Because, honestly, like, I should have just left. I should have been like, alright, this is obviously not going to do it. Like, she's not going to be able to take out any of these enemies. And if she does, it's going to take up, like, almost all of the stamina of this weapon. I need to just get out and grind. But I figured, you know what? I'm just going to keep pushing through. Which, I mean, I guess ended up working out in my favor anyways, but... So, like I was saying earlier, I think what might happen... Because if I remember correctly, I'm pretty sure you need your allies to be pretty... To have some decent equipment. Specifically, obviously, you have your limited zones where you're only going to be able to use them. But, also, like, it's... I feel like I remember that being a pretty big thing of like making sure your allies were well equipped. So I think what we might end up having, and we'll see how it pans out later on once we get more allies. But I think we're definitely gonna have to make sure that like once we get a new ally, maybe go back to some earlier floors or see what kind of items we have. just to make sure that we're well equipped going forward. So here we go. Curse is the other one. So luckily, luckily I was able to get it right. And you saw there, what's super exciting is I finally got a sword. So we'll see that put to use pretty soon. But I'm super pumped. I'm super pumped to finally have an actual, like, a new weapon that's not a dagger. We'll talk about that a little bit later, because there's some stuff, there's some upgrading we do with the dagger and that weapon we just got, which is pretty cool. Yep, still one. I like her weapon. I like having a slingshot. It's a pretty cool. I feel like that's a pretty uncommon weapon. I mean, I guess this is the more and more I read up on Dark Cloud, obviously this was definitely something that was positioned as like a very like, this is positioned as like another like Zelda kind of thing, although it's very different, of course. So I guess from that aspect, like, a slingshot isn't that uncommon, but it feels uncommon. It feels like we don't have a lot of games where you're wielding a slingshot, which is kind of cool. We need to upgrade that quite a bit. It gets some good upgrades soon, but definitely need to put some more into it. Alright, so I'm pretty sure this is where this happens. So part of the upgrading system with the weapons in this game is when you max out like an upgrade for a weapon, you can turn it into the sphere something. And you can status break it. I think we upgrade it first again. So I thought +5 was the fullest you could go, but we go +6 with the dagger. Now if I'm doing something wrong here, let me know. If I should have kept the dagger and upgraded a little bit more, or something, let me know. But so we status break it and turn it into a sense sphere. And maybe I can go plus. Maybe I was supposed to go plus 10. But anyway, we do it here at plus 6. And then what happens is we can place the Sense Sphere into the slot for the base lard or the basilard or whatever. And here's where it happens. This is pretty good. It's gonna be pretty good. Trust me. Go to customize. Yes. Okay, so maybe it didn't increase it like a ton, but the speed is at max now, so that's pretty cool. but I'm pretty stoked about that. I'm really excited to have an actual new weapon. Now see, here's the thing though. We have to make sure this weapon doesn't break. Like, we've been pretty good about the dagger so far. We had some close calls. But like, if there now it's like to the point where it's like, all right, we got to make sure this weapon doesn't break, because I don't want to lose the work I put into this. Which, I mean, you know, like, yeah, it's, I feel like a lot of this game is kind of like that. A lot of this is very much like, okay, you know, this is, you got to put, you're putting a lot of work into it. You know, you are going all out, and like from your village, like you're putting work into your village and you're designing it and making it, rebuilding it, and then the weapons, the same deal. It's like you're working to make these weapons good, or at least better than they normally are. We just keep on trucking. I guess the funny thing about this being a game that was kind of like, apparently, I mean, I guess I don't really remember it that much, because it's not like I wasn't following like games press and marketing that much like around the time this game came out, but I guess this game was positioned as like a Zelda killer, and obviously like no. But I guess it's kind of funny, because I feel like if you just played like the sound effects, maybe not the music. Maybe the music you could probably pinpoint. Maybe. I don't know. This is pretty standard like temple dungeon music. I was thinking like the sound effects that your characters make when you attack, and some of the other little sound effects. I feel like if you like close your eyes and just listen to those sound effects, I think I would probably say this is a Zelda game or something. Or my guess would like, oh, this is some Zelda game, I don't know. And then I would see a video and be like, oh, no, it's not. it's not even close. It's a, I guess it reminds me, we were having this conversation before I left work tonight, and our cash registers have the Sonic sound, which is apparently a thing. I knew it was a thing around locally, Or like the sound that plays when you collect a coin on Sonic. Like the ring sound. Apparently that's a thing, that's just a sound that also plays when like something, when people are, like when you ring up something on a cash register. And we were like talking, and there was a thread on NeoGAF, which is what brought it up again. Because it's something I've heard for years, whether it was at work or just at some other place around town. And I've always wondered, like, man, what? Like, what? Because it caught me off guard at first, and I just kind of got used to it. And I just figured, like, it's Sonic, you know, following me around throughout my daily life. Reminding me of what once was. But, I guess there was a thread on GAF with some people asking about why that's the case, and I guess there's a tweet sent out to the Sonic the Hedgehog Twitter account. I don't know that there's been a reply yet, but I anxiously await that reply to see if we can get an explanation as to why that sound effect is used. I don't know if it's like just some royalty-free sound effect or something like that. Maybe it's on some like stock library of sound effects. I don't know, but it's always seemed kind of funny to me. Especially here's the thing that really grinds my gears is oftentimes I've heard people hear that and be like, "Oh, that's from Mario," and I don't say anything, but inside, in my heart, I just think, no, that's Sonic, not Mario. But who am I? Who am I to tell people that they're wrong? So I let it go. Slingshot plus one. I think that's all we upgraded today, but it helped. It helped a lot. Sure, as you'll see. Spoilers. So we have about, I think it's like 20 minutes left in this video. I don't want to spoil anything for me, since we do have our Game of the Year stuff coming up, but I have been, a couple nights ago I spent some time kind of putting together like what my favorites of the year have been. And it has been, yeah, 2015's been nuts. Like, not just for announcement, like 2015 obviously, the year of dreams. The year that just everything got announced, everything we could ever want, or most things, I guess. but it's also just been really good. Like, it's been a really good year for just some really high quality games, from Bloodborne to Yoshi's Woolly World to everything. I've been playing Xenoblade Chronicles X. That game's pretty cool. It's crazy, and it felt like there's been times where it just felt like the games just kept coming. They didn't stop. They still are not stopping. Like, the Chapter 2 King's Quest is out this week. That's crazy. I keep forgetting that. And, like, Chapter 1 is probably, it's probably up there. I'll say that much. Like, it's probably up there as one of my favorite things I've played this year. And, like, if you haven't and you have PlayStation Plus, please do yourself a favor and like download King's Quest Chapter 1, because it's really good, and it's like, it's a lot longer than a lot of the episodic games that you might think of. Like, it's a much bigger thing than a lot of those games are, and it's just really good. I don't even have, like, an attachment to King's Quest at all. But, like, it's the kind of thing where, like, growing up, I loved a lot of, like, that kind of style, that period, like, knights and dragons and all sorts of, you know, stuff like that. And I loved, we had this Renaissance fair that is, usually comes around fall time, close to town. I've only been there a couple times, but I love going there because I just loved, like, you know, King Arthur and all that type of stuff. Like, I was super into that stuff when I was a kid. I still am, maybe not as much as when I was younger. But King's Quest has that feeling, like, that kind of stuff, that it very much feels like something of that kind of style. And it really, like, it brought me back in a big way. And it was, I just, you know, the voice work and the characters and just the way that game looks, the humor, everything about it just really hit so perfect. And I'm stoked for Chapter 2. I am super, super excited for it. Hopefully the other chapters aren't 6 months apart as well, but I am stoked for Chapter 2. You'll get that in, like, Parappa. I don't know where King's Quest would fit in for me. I don't know, like, if it's... We try to come up with top fives. I don't know that I have a specific top five just yet of PSN stuff, but... things that aren't PSN, like, I mean, Undertale, I feel like is the obvious, like... That's the game everyone's talking about. Or at least that feels like the game, like, I feel like every year there's, like, one or two games that, like, just come out of nowhere, for the most part, and just takes everyone, by storm, and, like, everyone starts talking about it, and everyone's like, you gotta play this game, and it really spreads like wildfire, and I feel like Undertale was that game this year, in a lot of ways, not that there weren't others, but I feel like that's the one that's really caught fire and kept going. I'm not as crazy about it as some other people are, but it's really good, like, and if you haven't played it, you should. It's got some really just genuinely great characters, and I feel like anything that is very obviously inspired by Earthbound is a-okay in my book. Citizens of Earth is actually a game that came out very, very early, like, in January of this year. I think Eric reviewed it, the PS4 version. I played it on Vita. And that game's really cool. Like, that's actually something that if you're, you know, we're like, approaching the time when games are actually stopped not coming out anymore, and, like, you're going home for the holidays, or, you know, maybe your free time is opening up a little bit more for Christmas and stuff. And if you're looking to go back and maybe checking out something that came out this year that you missed, like, that actually wouldn't be a bad choice. The Citizens of Earth is... It's very just quirky and kind of a... more simple, like, RPG, very much Earthbound inspired. Not that it's that quality. I mean, there's not very many games that are as good as Earthbound. The list is small, I would say, but it's definitely got that kind of feeling, that style of humor. It's got a really cool premise where you, like, play as the vice president saving the world, and to do so, you're recruiting citizens of Earth. So you're recruiting, like, the mailman, or the police officer, or the firefighter, or the teacher, or any other number of just, like, I think, like, the baker is one. There's a few others. You just like random people, like, who just have their everyday normal jobs, like, teaming together. Some of the, I want to say there's like 40 or some recruitable characters you can get. I never got all of them, but I really enjoyed it. I know the Vita version had some longer load times. I don't know if that's something that's been fixed by now, because it wasn't cross-buy. But I really liked it a lot. I think Eric liked it too. And that was something that, I don't know, maybe it'll go on sale or something. It's been out for a while, so that is definitely something that you might want to check out if you haven't. But yeah, like, going back over and looking at, like, everything that's been out this year and everything I've played, other things that are not PSN related, there's obviously, like I mentioned, Yoshi's Woolly World. That game is freaking awesome. It's so good. It is way too good. I think it's one of the best looking games this year. I mean, obviously that's more of an artistic standpoint, maybe not as much technical, although like, it does, like, the yard, like, there's straight up parts where if you look close enough, you can see, like, the fuzz on the yarn. If that might, I don't know if there's, like, a term for it, but if you think about, like, yarn, and sometimes there's, like, a little bit of fuzz that's, like, coming out of it. You can kind of actually see that on some of the characters. And that's nuts. That's insane. That's, like, a level of detail beyond what you would expect. And, I mean, I loved, like, Kirby's Epic Yarn. That was actually my favorite game of that year that it came out, I think 2010. Yoshi's Woolly World is incredible. It is so good. It's... oh, man. It's way too good. Way too good. I mean, obviously, I feel like the one that... I wish I could put it on my list, but I feel like I'm gonna have to keep it at, like, an honorable mention is the Resident Evil Remake HD that came out earlier this year, also I think in January. I played through that game 7 times this year, all within like 2 weeks or something. Now granted, that's a game that after one or two playthroughs you can get through in like 90 minutes to 2 hours or something like that, so it's pretty short, but I think that's the best Resident Evil game ever. Point, like, period. I mean, I know that, like, it's weird. I think RE4 is great, but I also, like, I prefer the style of Resident Evil 1, 2, and 3. So I kind of prefer those games personally. Just because I feel like they're so different from 4 and 4. Like, again, nothing against 4. 4 is great. But I feel like, for me personally, 1, 2, and 3 are kind of more up my alley. And I look at the Resident Evil 1 remake, and I think that is maybe one of the best remakes ever. It's something I kind of mentioned to other people, even knowing what we do now about the Final Fantasy VII remake, I often feel like, man, I wish that, like, I hope people who are working on that Final Fantasy VII remake look at the Resident Evil remake and try to understand why that is so perfect. I could get into this long conversation about why it is so, like, why it is an incredible remake. But that would be a very long thing. And also at the same time, like, I mean, Capcom is remaking Resident Evil 2. And I would hope that they're also looking at the Resident Evil remake and saying, okay, why is this, like, what is it about this remake that we nailed, and what is it that we can improve on personally? And it's actually an interesting, I guess, topic, and maybe something that would be worth discussing maybe on the podcast with everybody else, since we're, like, reviewing games and giving game scores and stuff, and typically, you know, we review a game right after we finish playing it, and so it's fresh in our mind. And maybe it hasn't had a lot of time to sit. There have been some times where I've let a game sit for a few days before writing. But usually, like, we finish it and maybe the next day or two we write the review. And it's funny because I actually look back, I was looking back on, like, all the games I've reviewed this year and what scores I gave it and, like, what I liked and what I didn't like, just to kind of, as a refresher. And I just kind of laugh because the Resident Evil HD Remake review, I think I gave, like, 4 stars. And it's funny because, like, honestly, now that time has passed and I think back upon that game, that was, like, when I beat the game once or twice. Like, that was before I played through it another, like, 5 or 6 times. I think that's, like, one of my favorite games ever. I think it's the best Resident Evil game, but I think it's maybe... it's probably in my top 10, like, favorite games of all time. And so I think it's kind of funny that, like, I don't really agree with that score anymore. I actually think that score's too low for what that game is. And it was also funny because I feel like I've given a lot of pretty high scores to games this year. And on the one hand, like, I kind of was like, man, is that weird? Like, am I too lenient? But then at the same time, like, I looked at what those games are, and it's like, well, like, those games are legitimately that good, so, or at least I enjoyed them that much, you know? But yeah, I just thought it was funny with Resident Evil that, like, I have, like, my one complaint is, like, such a minor thing that only really, I guess, probably I care about, or maybe a handful of other people. But that's how it goes. That said, the Resident Evil remake is pretty darn good. I had a ton of fun, like, especially streaming that earlier this year. I think one of my final streams I did, we just had, like, a ton of people in there chatting the whole time, which is a lot of fun. Specifically, like, man, playing that game, like, once you, like, know the... It's one of the only games that I've played so much in a short period of time that I knew everything, like, the back of my hand. And when you know, like, the ins and outs of a game like that in such detail and you know, like, everything, like, once you start, like, autopiloting it, like, it... I feel like it took my enjoyment of that game to another level, in a way. Not so much the autopilot, but I just, like, got so good at that game. And when I was playing it on, I guess, like, the survival mode, which is, like, the hardest difficulty, but there was also, it was the one where, like, you could store your items in those chests, but they would stay to that specific chest and not transfer throughout the game. And so there was a lot of, like, thinking ahead and thinking, like, okay, well, I could put this, you know, healing spray here, but if I do that, I need to realize that it's not going to show up in the other storage containers maybe later on into a different area. So it was, like, constantly thinking ahead and planning out every move, and, like, even planning, like, you know, 30 to 40 minutes in advance, knowing of, like, where I was heading and being like, okay, well, I'm about to go to this area. I know the enemies in this area, and I know for a fact I'm going to need some of these items or these weapons to get by and survive. And that was just exhilarating, especially because, like, I got through probably, like, 80% of that game without dying. Or, like, I think I ended up dying 3 or 4 times, like, in the same area, because there's one of the there's an enemy that can one-shot you in that game. And but I got really far into it without dying, and I was super, like proud of myself, but also just really happy with that mode and, like, just having a blast with it. And it makes me, like, I'm excited for the Resident Evil Zero, one that's coming out, I think in a month or so. I think it's about a month from now. Obviously, I know it's not gonna be the same quality, but I'm excited to at least check that out, because I never played that game. So I believe the plan here is we finish up this floor, and then there's some final stuff we do in the village to wrap up the episode. So we're getting close. Yep, yeah, so we just got Paige. And so with Paige, we can kind of wrap up everything. I forgot the King Mimic. This episode felt like we just ran into a ton of mimics. Especially early on. There was just so many. There were so many mimics. Got some windmill blades. And the lamp. Very close call. So at any rate, once again, sorry for the audio issue here and this being post-commentary. I'm sure it's... hopefully it turned out okay. Hopefully there was some interesting stuff that we could discuss and you can share your thoughts on, but videos will continue daily and hopefully be back to how they normally should be. I'll be sure to double check to make sure that my mic is selected when recording videos in the future, because that is not a fun thing to find out when after you spent about an hour plus recording a video like this, knowing that, like, man, I got, god dang it. especially because I saved over my save file already. So, like, I had already saved multiple times in this episode, and there was no going back. There was no going back, so. And with that, I believe the last few minutes here we're wrapping up with the Nelruin Village. Specifically, we get to finish off Paige's house, which is cool, and that leads to an event. There's something specific. She gives us something pretty important. I don't remember what it is right now. But we'll find out together. I think I have an idea of what it might be. There it is. Oh, yeah, so this is the part where I try to connect the river and the pond, and it's just not having it. It just seems so weird. I mean, I don't know. It just seems strange that you can't connect them. Maybe there's something I'm missing there. It just seems like a natural thing that you would just be able to do. But maybe not. Man, just look at this village. Look at this just looks so cool. Very happy with how it turned out, or how it is turning out. We got a little bit more to go. But with that said, I think we're about to wrap up on Paige's stuff. So I'm gonna end my recording here. And then I'll just let you guys watch how this wraps up here, because I thought this was pretty cool. I mean, all right, well, we've seen events before, but we'll end on here. And so once again, thank you for watching. Sorry you had to deal with this weird like post commentary thing. Hopefully it turned out okay at the very least. And if not, we'll be back to our regular kind of video series tomorrow. So. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all later.